អង្គុយចុះអង្គជំនុំជម្រះប្រកាសបន្តកិច្ចដំណើរការនីតិវិធីសន្និការសន្និការនៅថ្ងៃនេះអង្គជំនះធ្វើសន្និការនឹងស្ដាប់ចម្លើយតបការឆ្លើយតបឬក៏អត្ថាធិប្បាយកត់សម្គាល់ទៅតបទៅនឹងការដាក់បង្ហាញឯកសារកន្លឹះរបស់សាភិញ្ញានិងសហមន្ត្រីការពារក្តីពាក់ព័ន្ធនឹងអង្គហេតុលក្ខណៈនៃចំនួនប្រដាប់អាវុធហើយនឹងបន្តស្ដាប់តក្កីកម្មសាក់សី PTTW 1065បញ្ចប់ក្រុមយីសន្និការកញ្ញាជាស៊ីហ្វងនៅរាយការណ៍អំពីស្ថានភាពវត្តមានអវត្តមានភាគីនិងបុគ្គលដែលអង្គជំរះក៏អញ្ជើញឲ្យចូលរួមក្នុងកិច្ចដំណើរការសន្និការថ្ងៃនេះ
សូមគោរពលោកប្រធានសម្រាប់សន្និការនៅថ្ងៃនេះក្រុមជីកាត់សម្គាល់ឃើញថាគ្រប់ភាគីទាំងអស់នៃរឿងក្តីនេះមានវត្តមានដែលឡែកលោកនួនជាមានវត្តមាននៅបន្ទប់ឃុំខ្លួនខាងក្រោមសាសនាការនេះដែលលោកស្នាសុំលះបង់សិទ្ធិមានវត្តមានដោយផ្ទាល់ទីបន្ទប់សាសនាការនៅថ្ងៃនេះលិខិតលះបង់សិទ្ធិរបស់លោកនួនជាបានប្រគល់ដល់កឡាបញ្ជីរួចហើយសាក់សៃដែលត្រូវមកផ្ដោតសិក្ខាកម្មបន្ទាប់ពីការបញ្ចប់សាសនាការស្ដីពីការដាក់បង្ហាញឯកសារគន្លឹះនៅថ្ងៃនេះមានរហស្សនាម PTCW 1065សាក់សៃមានវត្តមាននៅបន្ទប់រងចាំការកោះហៅពីអង្គជំនុំជម្រះសូមអរគុណលោកប្រធាន
បាទអរគុណកញ្ញាជាស៊ីហួងជាដំបូងនេះអង្គជំរះសម្រាប់លើសំណើសុំរបស់ជនជាប់ចោតនួនជាមុនសិនអង្គជំរះបានទទួលលិខិតសុំលះបង់សិទ្ធិចូលរួមសកម្មការដែលផ្ទាល់ក្នុងបន្ទប់សកម្មការនេះរបស់ជនជាប់ចោតនួនជាចុះថ្ងៃទី7ខែវិច្ឆិកាឆ្នាំ2016ហើយបានបញ្ជាក់ថាគាត់មានបញ្ហាសុខភាពឈឺក្បាលឈឺចង្កេះមិនអាចអង្គុយយូរបានមិនអាចផ្ចង់អារម្មណ៍បានយូរនឹងដើម្បីមានលទ្ធភាពចូលរួមសកម្មការនេះថ្ងៃខាងមុខឲ្យមានប្រសិទ្ធភាពខ្លួនធំលះបង់សិទ្ធិចូលរួមនឹងមានវត្តមានដែលផ្ទាល់នៅក្នុងបន្ទប់សកម្មការនៅថ្ងៃទី7ខែវិច្ឆិកាឆ្នាំ2016បានឃើញកំណត់ហេតុវិនិច្ឆ័យសុខភាពជនជាប់ចោតនួនជាដែលធ្វើឡើងដោយគ្រូពេទ្យប្រចាំការវិនិច្ឆ័យព្យាបាលថែទាំសុខភាពជនជាប់ចោតនៅអពតកចុះថ្ងៃទី7ខែវិច្ឆិកាឆ្នាំ2016បានកត់សម្គាល់ពីស្ថានភាពសុខភាពរបស់លោកនួនជានៅថ្ងៃនេះថាមានអាការៈឈឺចង្កេះពេលអង្គុយយូរនិងបានផ្ដល់អនុសាសន៍ថាសូមឲ្យអង្គជំរះអនុញ្ញាតឲ្យលោកនុនជាចូលរួមតាមដានកិច្ចដំណើរការសកម្មការពីបន្ទប់មួយស្ថិតក្រោមសាសនាការនេះផ្អែកលើមូលដ្ឋាននេះនឹងយោងតាមបទបញ្ញត្តិនៃវិធាន815នៃវិធានផ្ទៃក្នុងអវតកអង្គជំរះអនុញ្ញាតឲ្យជនជាប់ចោតនុនជាចូលរួមនឹងតាមដានកិច្ចដំណើរការសកម្មការពីចម្ងាយពីបន្ទប់ឃុំខ្លួនមួយស្ថិតក្រោមសាសនាការនេះតាមរយៈឧបករណ៍សោទស្សន៍សម្រាប់រយៈពេលសកម្មការពេញមួយថ្ងៃនេះក៏ឲ្យបុគ្គលិកផ្នែកសុខទោសជួបប្រព័ន្ធសុខទោសសម្រាប់ជនជាប់ចោតនួនជាអាចចូលរួមនឹងតាមដានកិច្ចដំណើរការសន្និការពីចម្ងាយក្នុងឡុងពេលនៃកិច្ចដំណើរការសន្និការសម្រាប់ថ្ងៃនេះមុននឹងផ្ដល់វិធានការជូនទៅភាគីដើម្បីធ្វើការឆ្លើយតបឬក៏សម្គាល់ទៅនឹងការដាក់ឯកសារគន្លឹះដែលបានធ្វើការពីថ្ងៃប្រហ័សកន្លងមកនេះអង្គជំរះសូមជម្រាបជូនភាគីថាថ្ងៃនេះដោយសារមានបញ្ហាការបកប្រែភាសាអ្នកបកប្រែភាសាមិនគ្រប់គ្រាន់ដោយសារមូលហេតុស្ទះចរាចរណ៍មកមិនទាន់ដូច្នេះសូមឲ្យការនិយាយរបស់អរលោកលោកស្រីនៅក្នុងឡងពេលដំណើរការដែលខ្វះអ្នកបកប្រែភាសានេះសូមនិយាយយឺតៗដើម្បីឲ្យអ្នកបកប្រែបកភាសាបានទាន់ពីព្រោះមានការខ្វះជាពិសេសអ្នកបកប្រែភាសាខ្មែរឬភាសាបារាំងតែម្ដងបាទជាបន្តទៅនេះអង្គមាសផ្ដល់វិធានការជូនទៅថាមន្ត្រីនាំមុខតំណាងដើមម្ដងរដ្ឋប្រមេនីដើម្បីមានឱកាសធ្វើការឆ្លើយតបឬក៏តំកល់ទៅនឹងភាគីផ្សេងផ្សេងទៀតដែលបានដាក់ឯកសារគន្លឹះប្រសិនបើមានបំណងធ្វើដូច្នេះ
បាទសូមគោរព
បាទកុំអត់តន់ទាំងសូមជញ្ជិញលោកស្រីមេធាវីអង្តាគីសេមានបញ្ហាអីទៅ
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Bonjour. Je suis désolée d'interrompre mon confrère des partis civils. Je veux simplement rappeler à la Chambre que j'ai adressé ce week-end un mail demandant à pouvoir faire une requête orale devant la Chambre suite aux communications que nous avons reçues de l'accusation de certains documents relatifs aux témoins TCW. 953 qui doit venir après le témoin de TCW 1055. Et compte tenu du fait que nous demandons qu'il y ait un renvoi de sa déposition compte tenu des communications, pourrait savoir s'il y a possibilité de traiter la question maintenant ou à tout le moins ce matin pour que nous sachions comment nous organiser. Donc je voulais attirer l'attention de la Chambre sur ce point et je reste à l'écoute du moment que je puisse faire ma requête.
Good morning, Mr. President. The prosecution will be able to respond.
អញ្ជើញធ្វើការនេះតែម្ដងទៅឬក៏ទៀមទាសូមឲ្យមានការបង្ហាញច្បាស់លាស់នៅលើសំណើសុំរបស់ខ្លួនជាដំបូងនេះសូមឲ្យថាមេធាវីការពីក្តីខៀវសំផនបង្ហាញនៅសំណើសុំរបស់ខ្លួនឲ្យបានលម្អិតជាងនេះបន្តិចដើម្បីឲ្យភាគីពាក់ព័ន្ធផ្សេងទៀតនឹងមានការយល់ដឹងជាពិសេសថាធានជនយល់ដឹងពីបញ្ហាចំពោះមុខនាពេលនេះសូមអញ្ជើញ
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Très brièvement, vendredi à midi, nous avons reçu une nouvelle déclaration de TCW 953 qui avait été prise par le juge d'instruction dans le cadre d'une autre affaire. Un petit peu avant 16h, nous avons reçu un enregistrement audio de cette déclaration sur un DVD pour une durée de 7h50. Nous avons reçu ces éléments vendredi après-midi. Pour mémoire, la Chambre a donné la liste des témoins qu'elle entendait appelés sur le rôle des accusés le 14 septembre 2016. Le témoin de TCW 953 était sur les listes des procureurs depuis, il me semble, 2014. Là encore, je parle de mémoire. Aujourd'hui, nous sommes dans la situation du côté de l'équipe de Khieu Samphan où vendredi après-midi, nous avons de nouveaux éléments sur un segment crucial qui est le segment du rôle des accusés. Le procureur aura certainement des explications à donner sur le pourquoi cette communication aussi tardive, alors que la déposition de ce témoin arrive et prévue pour mardi. Mais en tout état de cause, du côté de la défense de Khieu Samphan, on vous dit tout de suite, nous n'allons pas pouvoir interroger ce témoin mardi, compte tenu des éléments qui nous ont été fournis vendredi après-midi. C'est important que je dise les choses, que j'essaie d'aller doucement, parce que j'ai compris qu'il y a un problème de traduction ce matin. Mais c'est important pour moi de rappeler que du côté de l'équipe de Khieu Samphan, on essaye de faire les choses au mieux pour ne pas retarder les choses. Il y a un moment, il y a des choses qu'on ne peut pas faire, c'est-à-dire on ne peut pas bâcler la défense d'un client. Concrètement, la nouvelle déclaration de TCW 953 à 23 pages en anglais. Nous n'avons pu remettre ce document que ce matin à M. Khieu Samphan, ce qui veut dire que pour un témoin qui a priori vient en partie déposé sur le rôle de M. Pressampan. Nous n'avons pas pu ni analyser correctement ces nouvelles déclarations et encore moins écouter l'ensemble de l'enregistrement qui, pour nous, est quelque chose d'important puisque ça permet d'avoir éventuellement des nuances et de pouvoir interroger correctement un témoin. Donc, ce que nous demandons à la Chambre, compte tenu de ces communications tardives, c'est de faire en sorte que la déposition de ce témoin de TCW 953 soit repoussée après le recess prévu pour la fête des eaux, de façon à ce que nous puissions travailler dans des conditions correctes. J'anticipe, je ne sais pas ce que va indiquer le procureur sur la question, mais j'anticipe pour rappeler, alors c'est toujours la contrainte de la défense peut-être, que vous êtes fatigué de l'entendre, mais je suis obligé de rappeler que le travail que nous faisons à l'audience n'est que le sommet de l'iceberg et que nous faisons tout en même temps, toujours les mêmes. C'est-à-dire que lorsque nous avons un expert, c'était nous. Lorsqu'il y a une audience de documents à préparer, à présenter, c'est nous. Lorsqu'il y a les réponses à présenter, c'est nous. Lorsqu'il y a des témoins à préparer, c'est encore nous. Et qu'à un moment, dans le cadre de la préparation, dans le cadre d'une répartition du travail au sein de notre équipe, il y a des choses qui sont difficiles à faire dans un certain laps de temps. Et là, concrètement, nous arrivons à un moment où, là, ce n'est pas possible, à moins de faire les choses au détriment de la défense de notre client. Donc, voilà très clairement la demande que nous formulons. Que ce témoin qui était prévu pour mardi soit repoussé après le recess, compte tenu des éléments récemment donnés à l'équipe de Pyeongchang. Enfin, à l'ensemble des parties, en tout cas pour nous, je vous ai indiqué quels sont les problèmes concrets que nous avons. Vraiment, je vous le dis un peu avec force parce que ces derniers temps, nous n'arrêtons pas de jongler, faire des grands écarts, nous adapter, mais il y a un moment où c'est plus possible. Donc, voilà la demande et nous espérons que de l'autre côté de la barre, il y aura au moins un soutien sur ce point-là. Je vous remercie, Monsieur le Président, d'avoir autorisé la présentation de cette requête.
Thank you, Mr. President. The prosecution is well aware of Khmer's position and the defense position. It applies to the prosecution. It's a very busy trial. There's lots of documentation that we all have to deal with in Manchester. And perhaps, if I can make some observations and leave the decision in your hands as to whether or not the witness should be postponed. But firstly, I should give an explanation why the statement was disclosed only on Friday as opposed to some months earlier. The defense is correct when the witness list was put forward by the prosecution as they wanted. This statement was not on that list. There were DCK and CAM statements on the list. And the reason being is that this statement didn't come into an existence. It wasn't taken until February this year by the OCIJ. And then when the witness list came out from the trial chamber, on the 14th of September, of course, the prosecution did all of the searches required to make sure that any new material arose in the investigation since the documents were put forward back in 2014 was made available. The problem we had was an electronic search issue. This witness, when you look at the statements from DCCAM, the two statements, and the summary of the statement, this witness has four different names, four different permutations of the name. And then when we look at the statement, this is why the prosecution didn't discover it. When we look at the statement that was taken by OCIJ earlier this year,
It was listed under a different name.
It was a slight similarity,
but not similar enough that when the prosecution conducted the searches for the four different names that appeared on the DCCAM statements, it did not bring up this new statement. So the prosecution made all due efforts to make sure all the statements are with the defence, but the electronic system didn't pick up the different names. None of the names in the DCCAM statement were contained in the OCIJ statement in February this year. So the prosecution had done its searches, but because of the difference in names, it was discovered. And how was it discovered? It was because searches were being done on certain locations relating to this witness, and when a search was done on a location relating to this witness, this statement from OCIJ came up through that search term. And that led us to discover, and that was late on Friday morning, this new statement. The prosecution wasn't aware this statement was a statement in relation to this witness that was coming on Tuesday. So in that respect, and that's the reason why it was discovered so late. In terms of whether the witness should be postponed, Your Honours, we would like to observe that it is a 23-page statement. It's a statement in a question and answer format. It's not in the usual paraphrasing format that sometimes the OCIJ statements are. The audio tape was provided at 4 o'clock on Friday evening, so more than likely the audio tape and the statement would be very similar. We would ask that whatever decision Your Honour makes, put off after the water festival, that the examination and cross-examination be put off at the same time, so we question under the same conditions. In terms of whether it should go ahead on Tuesday, the prosecution always determined that this trial is fair to the prosecution and the defence, and so we're in Your Honour's hands, but we do note that it's a question and answer statement, rather than a paraphrase one, so the tape and the statement was very similar. In terms of the issue of disclosure, there's a new system, as Your Honour is aware, or new guidelines afforded by the investigative judges, and that's contained in decisions D193/102. And D193/103, and that decision from the OCIJ, I apologise. Those decisions from the OCIJ, which were made available last week, has now allowed the prosecution to provide material, whether it be exculpatory or, in that exceptional circumstances, 87.4, to be able to be disclosed and used in the trial, the OCIJ will take their decision.
Can I just ask one question?
Did I misunderstand correctly?
Merci. Monsieur le Président, je voudrais simplement faire quelques observations en réplique. Tout d'abord, je dois dire que je suis un peu déçu. J'aurais vraiment apprécié que du côté de l'accusation, on ait l'élégance de reconnaître que c'est vrai, quelles que soient les raisons informatiques qui aient concouru à ce problème de communication tardive, mais qu'on puisse reconnaître que c'est vrai.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Bonjour à tous. La requête de Kyo Sampan nous paraît raisonnable, compte tenu des délais. C'est un témoin qui doit comparaître demain.
Donc, nous ne nous opposons pas à la demande.
Ça me
plaît.
Yes, thank you, Mr. President. Good morning.
We believe that the request is reasonable as well.
In addition to this, there is no necessity to start the last segment with this particular witness. We could easily move this witness after the other witnesses. There are still
problems to discuss it.
I don't think there's any reason to
for
concerns of delay.
So I think it's reasonable
and it can be executed fairly easily.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. J'étais un petit peu impatiente de reprendre le micro en disant que oui, j'ai été effectivement un peu déçue de la manière dont l'accusation a répondu, parce que c'est toujours préjugé de la manière dont nous nous organisons dans le cadre de notre travail en défense. Et j'aurais apprécié qu'il ait la même élégance que l'éco-avocat des parties civiles ce matin. En tout état de cause, oui, 7h50 d'enregistrement. Je veux bien prendre la position de monsieur le procureur pour argent comptant. Et en tout état de cause, du côté de la défense de Kyo Sampan, nous n'allons pas faire l'économie d'écouter ces 7h50 d'enregistrement. Et comme le coprocureur a dû le faire dans le cadre de la préparation de ce témoin, rechercher les éléments connexes qui pourraient être utiles dans le cadre de cette nouvelle déclaration. Donc, je maintiens de plus fort la demande de délai effectué par la défense de Kyo Sampan en disant que nous la faisons évidemment à contre-cœur, mais que ce soit clair que ce sont les circonstances exceptionnelles de cette communication tardive qui sont à l'origine de notre demande.
ហើយវាជាផលវិបាកគឺដោយសារតែពេលវេលាខ្លែងអញ្ចឹងយើងខ្ញុំស្នើសុំដាក់សំណើផ្ទាល់មាត់ក្នុងពេលភ្លាមៗនេះតែម្ដងបាទអរគុណហើយចុះបើសិនបើភាគីនឹងបានត្រៀមនៅលក្ខណៈសម្បត្តិគ្រប់គ្រាន់នៅសម្រាប់ធ្វើសក្ខីកម្មសាក់សីមួយម្នាក់បន្ទាប់ទៀតដែលត្រូវធ្វើនៅថ្ងៃចាប់ថ្ងៃពិធីដប់ទៅសហប្រញ្ញាតំណាងសហប្រញ្ញាតើមានអាចត្រៀមខ្លួនរួចហើយឬនៅចំពោះសាក់សីបន្ទាប់ទៀតប្រសិនបើអង្គជំរះយកសាក់សីបន្ទាប់មកធ្វើចាប់ថ្ងៃអង្គារ
Thank you, Mr. President.
I
think that this is a civil party, so we would be asking questions second, but we'll obviously, unless I'm mistaken, on my schedule, the person who would follow is a civil party scheduled for 2 days. If I'm correct about that, we'll do our best.
As always, without any complaints to deal with the situation. ថ្ងៃស្អែកចាប់ថ្ងៃស្អែកទៅនឹងបានត្រៀមខ្លួនរួចហើយឬនៅវាមានបញ្ហាអីទេ
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Je ne sais pas si la partie civile est déjà arrivée à Phnom Penh. Elle est déjà là, apparemment, me confirme mon confrère. Après avoir discuté avec mon confrère, il semblerait que nous pourrions être prêts pour demain, pour que cette partie civile soit entendue demain et non pas initialement prévue.
No,
none whatsoever.
Maybe copy your human mean panya by the look then.
The crumb may be copy day here some pawn.
Évidemment, aucun problème, Monsieur le Président, puisqu'il s'agit d'accommoder notre demande.
Je suis en train de me faire un peu de temps. បាទជាបន្តទៅនេះប្រាប់ប្រជាជនទៅថាមិទ្ធិវីនមុកតំណាងដើមនឹងរដ្ឋនេះធ្វើការឆ្លើយតបឬក៏តង្កល់ទៅលើបណ្ដាឯកសារដែលដាក់បង្ហាញដោយភាគីសហប្រញ្ញានិងថាមិទ្ធិវីការពារក្តីនួនជាអង្គហេតុលក្ខណៈនៃចំនួនប្រដាប់អាវុធដែលបានដាក់បង្ហាញការពីថ្ងៃប្រហោះមុនសូមជឿញ
បាទសូមគោរពលោកប្រធានឧស្សាហកម្មនិងភាគីសម្រាប់ការឆ្លើយតបចំពោះភាគនៅពេលនេះខាងមេតាវីនមុខមិនមានអ្វីសម្រាប់ឆ្លើយតបទេសូមអរគុណលោកប្រធានបាទអរគុណហើយបន្តទៀតគឺបន្តពីការជូនទៅតំណាងសហប្រញ្ញាដើម្បីធ្វើការឆ្លើយតបឬក៏តម្កល់ទៅលើបណ្ដាឯកសារដែលដាក់បង្ហាញដោយថាមន្ត្រីការពារក្តីខៀវសំផន
Thank you, Mr. President. I'm going to start our response with the Philip Short book, it was cited extensively by the accused upon defense. That book, of course, is a Pol Pot history of a nightmare, document
E3/9.
Let me start with a few general comments.
First,
unlike Nayan Chanda and Stephen Morris,
Another
comment observation related to
some of the quotes.
For example, in the same section related to this 1975 conflict over the islands, and specifically relating to meetings that Pol Pot had with the Vietnamese leaders at that time, which the defense quoted as being a grand gesture of friendship. Philip Short expressly noted that Pol Pot's efforts with the Vietnamese were a calculated ruse, if you will. It was designed to buy him time to build up his military strength, not genuine friendship. And this is the quotes here. Cusum-Pontine was reading from French DRN 0063 9 6 3 7 3 9. The English of that is 0039 6 504 through 506. And this is not a, I believe, a section for which we have Khmer translations. But this is what Short wrote about these meetings. Quote, the calculation was simple. If, as Pol believed, Vietnam was the main potential long-term enemy, prudence required the maintenance of good relations, at least until Cambodia was strong enough to meet an eventual Vietnamese challenge. And continuing 2 pages later, the end of the year on range I just provided, describing the meetings that took place between the two countries. Short writes, quote, as the year ended, the Vietnamese Politburo concluded that relations were slowly improving and that despite strains, the alliance was intact. This was a fatal error. As the Vietnamese Foreign Minister Nguyen Co Thach subsequently acknowledged, and he quotes from him, in 1975, Vietnam evaluated the situation in Cambodia incorrectly. And then Short writes, Cusum-Pon said later that Pol was simply playing for time. End of quote. And Short does provide a source for this last reference, and that is, of course, the interviews he conducted himself of Cusum-Pon. We see the same stratagem, if you will, in the 11 March 1976. Standing committee minutes, just identify those two E3, the strategy of buying time to build up forces. Another observation relating to Philip Short, when you look, well, there are some differences on the whole when you read the various excerpts in his book on what took place with the armed conflict. It is essentially the same facts as what Nayan Chanda, what Stephen Morris, what Ben Kiernan have all written. There is not much disagreement between any of these authors on what took place between these two countries, though they, of course, they have some different opinions or characterizations of the events. But the essential facts are, for the most part, the same. And as an example, I read to you an excerpt from Ben Kiernan last week.
Pilipsot, Kabana Rebro, MP, Kabachum, Kaitlu, Jet Promoy, Kujaka, Pachum, Namitrium, Ripjam, Kavi, Paha, also describes this. Philip Shot, Kabana Rebro, MP, Jumatan, Mitchum, Kamakai, Tanu, Jet Promoy, Kujaka, Pachum, Namitrium, Ripjam, Kavi, Paha, also describes this. Philip Shot, Kabana Rebro, MP, Jumatan, Mitchum, Kamakai, Tanu, Jet Promoy, Kujaka, Pachum, Namitrium, Ripjam, Kavi, Paha, also describes this. Philip Shot, Kabana Rebro, MP, Jumatan, Mitchum, Kamakai, Tanu, Jet Promoy, Kujaka, Pachum, Namitrium, Ripjam, Kavi, Paha, also describes this. Philip Shot, Kabana Rebro, MP, Jumatan, Mitchum, Kamakai, Tan
And further evidencing what I'm saying, which is that Philip Short largely has a version of events that is consistent with the others.
Philip Short writes in his book
of the DK incursions into Vietnam on the 30th of April 1977 and the 24th of September 1977, in which Vietnamese civilians were massacred in the most barbaric manner possible. Short also notes that the Khmer Rouge committed similar atrocities that same year in Thailand. Short quotes Douglas Pike, another source that was used by the accused in their presentation. They quote Douglas Pike, or Short quotes Douglas Pike as describing Cambodia's, and I quote here, hostile, if not aggressive behavior towards Vietnam and Thailand as a, what he calls, a bristly dog gambit. Translate very well. You'll find them in Short's book at French 00639942-46, English 0386-58683, and again, as indicated in Q Sampan's presentation last week, this part of Short's book is not translated in Khmer at this time. Short also writes, I will note, that the Khmer Rouge's aggressive strategy of attacking first continued until October 1978. And I'll give you a quote here from French 00639964. English 00369657. A Short writes, quote, since January 1978, Khmer Rouge frontier units had been under orders to adopt an aggressive forward posture. We must attack first, because otherwise they will attack us, Holt said. After his return from Beijing in October 1978, the frontline commanders were told to switch to a defensive strategy, to use mines against Vietnamese armor and infantry formations, and to avoid decisive confrontations, which carried a risk of heavy losses. End of quote.
Vietnam, and
let me just finish with my observations on short. Notably different account
was
in his description of the first invasion by Vietnamese forces in December 1977. This reference you'll find at French 0039 9 4 9 English 0039 6 5 8 5. This is what Short wrote, so you understand what I'm about to say. In mid-December, 50,000 Vietnamese troops, backed by armor and artillery, poured across the border along a front stretch, a front stretching more than 100 miles. From the Parrot's Beak and Swy Ring to Snul and the north. In the first week, they met little resistance and penetrated about 12 miles into Cambodian territory. Let me stop. So far, this is consistent with the others. Here's where there is a little difference. Short continues. Khmer Rouge's soldiers who fell into their hands were systematically killed. Reinforcements were then sent in from the southwest, and in some areas, the Vietnamese forces were forced onto the defensive. This account of both of systematic killings, but also of southwest reinforcements arriving in time in December 1977 or early January 78 to drive back the Vietnamese, again, is not supported by any cited source, but by short here, it differs from the findings of the others, Chanda, Morrison, Kiernan. And it's inconsistent with both the December 77 reports, contemporaneous records that exist, and of course what you heard from some of the Southwest Zone military commanders about when it was that they were able to arrive in that region. So, the point is that in summary on Philip Short, we believe that with a few differences which are not sourced, Philip Short essentially comes to the same conclusions as the others. As Nayan Chanda, Stephen Morris, as Ben Kiernan.
Nayan Chanda, Stephen Morris, Ben Kiernan.
The Khieu Samphan defense also presented last Thursday some documents on the border issues and the border lines. They presented a March 1976 study conducted by the U.S. State Department on the Cambodia-Vietnam border issues, E3-2373, which refers to some of the decrees from the French colonial period. And then the council quoted an excerpt from some CPK standing committee minutes, E3-217, in which she noted that Vietnam had told Nguyen Chia the borders were made by the imperialists, quote-unquote. I'm not sure what point the defense was trying to make here, whether they're arguing that Cambodia and Vietnam were bound to accept all decrees or be the former colonial period, and that was wrong for either side in negotiations to question or raise issues about some of the border lines. I find that to be a little bit strange argument coming from the leaders of the Communist Revolutionary Movement. But to the extent the bigger point is just that there were disagreements about the borderline, and that was one of the principal reasons that led to the conflict. That was part of our document presentation, and it's something we obviously agree with. And next, the defense presented a number of meeting minutes and telegrams reporting on incidents in which Vietnamese people or soldiers intruded onto land that Democratic Kampuchea claimed was its territory. The defense described these as incursions that were suggesting they were equivalent to the Democratic Kampuchea incursion into Vietnam that took place beginning in March or April 1977. So there are a few observations I would like to make about these telegrams and meeting minutes. I would observe that when you are looking at any of these documents on these incidents on the border, it's important to ascertain as best you can whether these reports involve land that was part subject to the border disputes. That obviously makes a significant difference in understanding what was going on, because there were areas that both countries believed belonged to them. And that is exactly what was going on with one of the first documents presented by Khmer and Khmer. This is the 2 November 1975 Standing Committee Minutes, document 23-227. There were a number of documents relating to an area in Ratnakiri called Otabok. And these Standing Committee Minutes indicate that 130 people from Vietnam had entered this area, people who were described as ethnic Rode and apparently soldiers. But the minutes make very clear that this was an area that the Vietnamese people believed was part of their territory. Let me just read to you from the Standing Committee Minutes that were cited by the defense. E3-227, Khmer-000-193. A French 00290867-68. English 00183-413. This is what the Standing Committee minutes reflect. Quote, the situation at Otabok is confused. But in fact, there are Vietnamese there. According to what has been grasped, after withdrawing from Stung Treng in late July, 30 Vietnamese returned. When we told them to withdraw, they responded that it was their land, and later they reinforced. But the majority of them were ethnic Rode. Subsequently, they sent 100 people. When we objected officially, the South did not respond. The North responded, explaining that they welcomed the matter we told them about. They added that if examination showed it was truly our land, they would order these troops to withdraw. The defense quoted these minutes, a portion that suggests that the CPK leaders wanted to have a model of friendship. There's a portion of these notes that says, we will tell them to withdraw, we wish to have no clashes. If there are successes, we will solve them. We will be the model of friendship. That was the quote used by the Khmer defense. And I just want to observe and draw your honor's attention to what exactly the leaders in the standing committee considered a model of friendship to be. 9 days after the standing committee meeting was on the 2nd of November 1975, 9 days later on the 11th of November, the center sent instructions to the East Zone Secretary Yaw directing that forces be organized to attack the Vietnamese who had returned to Bok. And this is document E3/1150. I believe we read some of the excerpts from this last week, so I won't repeat them. They provide specific instructions to use grenades, mines, B-40, B-60 rocket launchers, specifically identifying the Oak to Bok area as one of the places. They say the assault shall continue for 3 to 4 months. Now, at the end of this telegram from the center, they do also suggest that Northeast Zone Secretary Yaw, and I will quote here, consider contacting their leaders to determine how to make a complaint against them through a political venue. And fortunately, in this case, that seems to have happened. Yaw, as I think you are aware from some of the documents, Yaw engaged in real negotiations with Vietnam. And he reported on those at a standing committee meeting held on the 26th of March 1976. This is another document that was presented, E3/218. And in section 1.2b of those standing committee minutes, it is reported regarding the situation in Rattnakiri that the Vietnamese had withdrawn from this area. So this is an example of where negotiations were genuinely pursued. These two countries were able to resolve the area. I must note here that Northeast Zone Secretary Yaw, having engaged in some relatively successful negotiations with Vietnam, seems to have been rewarded a few months later by being granted a traitor and sent to S-21 in August 1976, in reference OCCP S-21 list number 101. This is an observation I will make with a number of contemporaneous records that the defense has cited individuals who were reporting on the border situation with Vietnam. Most of them ended up in S-21. Another telegram that was included by the Khmer Sampon defense in their document list, E3/903. This is a 8 February 1976 telegram from Division 920 Secretary Chin. Reporting on a situation, some land in Mundakiri, on which the Vietnamese were located. Paragraph 1 of that telegram report, and let me read this to you. I'd like to report to brother about the border problem that the Vietnamese set up their bases in our territory. Our soldiers met with Tu Dik, who is in charge of the planting section. They camped along the Hik stream in Kutrak village. According to the information given by the region soldiers, they had moved 1 kilometer into our territory. We went to inspect all together. The Vietnamese did not recognize this border line. They said our map is not correct. our soldiers ordered them to withdraw completely from that place, but they have not done yet. End of quote.
So, my job got up
strong. I bring up because in 1976 we had these border incidents in both Ratnakiri and Mandalkiri. The subsequent telegrams from Division 920 Secretary Chin
show that
the response, ultimate response of Division 920
was to attack
and throw grenades at these Vietnamese people who weren't there engaged in violence. They believed the land was theirs. It seems from a February 1976 telegram, they were trying to farm the land. That is document E3-8377. Pursuant to the documents I described and presented last week, which I won't repeat,
The response of Division 920
was to begin attacking and throwing grenades at these Vietnamese, even while negotiations were going on
in the south border.
We also, the defense also presented a number of telegrams from 1977. Three telegrams, I believe. Some of which show fighting back and forth at the border areas. But in some cases, again, showing Democratic Kampuchea soldiers opening fire merely because they believe Vietnamese had intruded onto their territory. You'll see this. Let me give you one example. Document E3-8527, on 30 April 1977 at 5 p.m., identifying a target area in Trac Thi subdistrict, there were six Vietnamese who had pulled off some of our stakes. After realizing that, our colleagues started firing at them, leaving one dead. End of quote. Now, it's important to also always, in considering the telegrams and reports, you have to consider the time period and understand that. And it's important to note that the 3-1977 telegrams that were cited by the defense that do include some incidents of Vietnamese firing at Cambodian troops, let there be no mistake about that. Neither of these sides were angels. There was fighting being initiated by both sides as of 1977 and certainly 1978. But that's the important point. These telegrams are from April and June 1977, which is after the time of the first incursions by Democratic Kampuchea forces into Vietnam, which Kiernan dates at March 1977. He cites some incidents on the 15th to 18th of March and the 25th to 28th of March 1977. Just for the record, that's in Kiernan's book, E3-1593, Khmer 00637902-903, French 00639136-337. Okay. Let me repeat. Khmer 00637902-903, English 0115 0185 86 and French 00639 136 through 37. Another point on these telegrams, and I started with this observation, the Kusampon team were trying to make an equivalency between the Vietnamese incursions into Democratic Kampuchea that are described in these documents, and the incursions by Democratic Kampuchea forces that took place beginning in March of 1977. And I would observe that that is rather a false equivalency to try to reflect it in these documents. Taking rice and food, that probably led to the Democratic Kampuchea forces doing in their incursions in 1977 and 1977. This is what Nain Chanda was told by a witness who visited the site of the September 77 massacres a few days after it took place. In house after house, loaded, rotting bodies of men, women, and children lay strewn about. Some were beheaded. Some had their bellies ripped open. Some were missing limbs. Recalling the scene even a year later, Nam was overcome by nausea. And Chanda himself personally went to the scene of another massacre near Hà Tiên in March 1978. And this is what he described, what he saw. In a clearing, a dozen sweating, silent men were digging graves. Next to a completely gutted house lay 15 bodies, men, women, and children. Some of the staves with which they had been beaten to death still lay around. One stave was stuck between the legs of a spread-eagled naked woman. Her two children had been cut to pieces. A few bodies were headless. Some were disemboweled and covered with blue flies. I felt nauseated and had to rest briefly under a tree. House after house presented the same gory sight. You'll find these two accounts, Your Honors, in Nain Chanda's book, Brother Enemy, E3-2376, Khmer ERNs 00191526 and 560, English 00192379 and 192408 through 09, a French 0023706 and 2370862 through 87. And the reason that we brought up this evidence, and we've had argument about this, you cannot understand the conflict that took place without understanding what took place, the incursions of KK forces in Cambodia. These attacks were a triggering event that dramatically escalated the conflict and it changed the course of the relations that played out between these two countries in the 1977-78 period. And so it's important in looking at the documents presented by the Khmer Bon team to understand this difference. It is an important difference.
Intruding
onto someone's land, taking their property, is wrong. Make no mistake about that.
I was able to get a telegram to make an observation on the defense.
Presented document at E3-913, and this is a 15 January 1978 telegram that was sent by the Khmer, who was the East Zone Rubber Plantation Chairman, to Office in 70. It describes the damage that had been inflicted by the Vietnamese upon the Memot Rubber Plantation during the retaliatory invasion that had begun in December 1977 and ended after the first week of January 1978.
And
my observation on this is that there was obviously major damage that had been inflicted upon this rubber plantation as part of this retaliatory attack. In contrast to what Democratic Kampuchea forces did to Vietnamese civilians, there's no indication in this report that the Vietnamese killed any of the rubber plantation workers. And instead, if you look at this, what is reported is, and I quote, two families followed the enemy. One was a worker at SLA and another a former nurse for the guerrillas. So some of the people, the Cambodians, actually used this opportunity to get out of the country and follow the Vietnamese forces when they retreated. Let me just remark on a few more documents before I end. There was a number of
documents.